Dana Show.
From day one, my administration has been committed to fixing the broken student loan system and making sure higher education is a ticket to the middle class, not a barrier. My administration has approved debt cancellation for 4 million Americans through various actions. And today, I'm announcing new plans that would cancel student debt for millions more. In total, these plans would cancel some or all student debt for 30 million Americans when combined with everything we've done so far. To find out how these plans may impact you, visit studentaid.gov.
No. I need more coffee in my coffee. I need more bitterness in my coffee this morning. I really do. It's Monday, and I already got President Daddy Showers down here, sitting here promising all my money away. Promising all my money away to grad school brats. I said it! So you don't have to. It's Eclipse Mania Monday, by the way. And cedar season. I'm just doing it. You know what? Because people are like, why do you sound like... You know why? Because I, on a scale... First off, I'm going to get to everything, tell you who I am, blah, 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 you know. On a scale of 1 to 10, I am apparently level 20 allergic to cedar. I have to get, like, a whole new formulation of allergy shots and everything. That's why I sound like this. I'm not leaving Texas, though. It's not going to happen. We have our own gold and our own grid. Thank you. All right, so anyway, welcome to the program. Dana Lash with you. Starting a new week off, hatefully. And, wouldn't you be like this on a Monday? You have Biden telling everybody, well, we've got another round. What round is this? I'm on like 5 or 6, right? We're on 5 or 6 rounds of student loan forgiveness.
It is round 5.
Wait, I didn't forgive it. Nope. Did you forgive anything?
I didn't.
Juan didn't forgive nothing. I don't think Steve forgave anything. We didn't forgive nothing. But yeah, guess who gets sacked with all of it? Yeah, we all do. They'll get you some way or another. They will get you some way or another. So this is one of the big things that they're doing today, that they're announcing. They're pushing out this latest student loan, whatever, another one, because Biden's got to buy votes. Like, don't you find it fascinating that it's just now an issue for him? Just now. It's just now an issue for him. But it wasn't an issue for Democrats until they needed to buy the vote. I don't know what they're going to do going into the election year. I don't know what they're going to do. They can't buy everybody's vote because that'll make some people mad. I don't know what they're going to do. So there's kind of three big things sort of we're watching because the House is coming back into session. They've got to fight over the Ukraine stuff. And good luck with that. They have to fight over all the Ukraine stuff. Then you also have the GOP and abortion, which we're going to talk about coming up. Oh, I know. We're going to talk about it. I might surprise you with my analysis of the nominee, the RNC nominee, and his statement on this, because he came out, he posted a couple minute video to his platform, and he was discussing how he thinks it's something after the women's health, Jackson Women's Health case, and then the taking of Roe v. Wade. It was Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health, which then took Roe v. Wade and the jurisdiction of abortion, essentially, and kicked it down to the states, which is constitutionally correct. And we're going to talk about this in a very logical way, because as someone who defines themselves as pro-life, I want to win on the issue, and I want to win, I mean, like, win on the issue. You got to do it smart to win on the issue, and we're going to talk about this coming up. We're also going to discuss the effect that it may have on the November election, because if Democrats get their way, it will be the entirety of the election, which is asinine when you consider literally everything else that's happening around the world right now, to say nothing of energy, the economy, inflation. We had Carol Roth Thursday? We had her on Thursday.
Wednesday.
Was it Wednesday? I don't know. I was so depressed after. She always comes on with on the most depressing topic. She's so fun. And, at some point, we're going to have her on, and we're going to have, a party or something. But she's always on basically, yes, we're all going to die broke, and we're going to be eating, bugs in the desert. That's what's going to happen. And owe nothing, and we'll be told to be happy by the government. So, the economic situation, horrific. Then you have, I don't know, are we going to be in World War III? Biden keeps going this way. Yeah, then we've got this issue. And then Now you've got the and the Eclipse Mania today. But then you also, now you have, you know, Democrats are just focusing on, no, it's about abortion, ladies. I know we have all these issues, but we've got to worry about abortion. Got to worry about abortion. They're not going to sit here and tell you about crime. You know what? Crime concerns women. Women are disproportionately affected. They're not going to sit here and talk about crime to women. So they're going to try to scare you with abortion. It's the most sexist thing I can think of, because this isn't most. It aggravates me because it is an issue that older women use. Abortion is what older women use as a form of birth control. Though, don't get mad at me for sharing with you the publicly available on this tool called the internet, the statistics that are compiled by Planned Parenthood themselves and are made available to the public. Half of the public doesn't care. They want to run with their narrative, and they don't want to see any evidence to the contrary. They want to believe what they want to believe, and their belief is that you got people out there raping everybody and coat hangers galore in back alleys. That's what it is. That's what they want you to believe. And that's not the truth, actually. The truth is a lot more shocking, because it's older women who use it as a form of birth control. That is God's honest truth. Now, most Americans support, and by most, I mean the overwhelming majority, Democrats and Republicans and independents and everybody else, they come down on a 15-week ban. So the strategy of people who are define themselves as pro-life, because I'm not paying homage to this whole exception of the life of the mother, because it's included already. That's already codified in every single state statute. It's already in existence. So it feels silly to talk about whether or not something that exists because it exists. But having this go to the states, I would think gives pro-life people more of an advantage, because the Democrats are desperate to make this a national issue for one reason and one reason only. So like I said, we're going to talk about this here. Audio soundbite 15, though. Can you just hit me in the head with this, please? This is Secretary Mayor Poop Booty Juice. Go ahead. It's Monday.
So we need to talk about the reality here. And again, there is a lot of funding and a lot of energy going into telling a different story, especially on ideological news outlets and online. But the simple facts and the simple reality are right here staring us in the face, including the fact that I can safely walk my dog to the Capitol today in a way that you couldn't do when we all got here. And also,
I'm sorry, what? What's he talking about? That's Poop Booty Juice. And I just was reading a story about a man who was literally beaten to death in a DC alley. Did you hear about that one? Yeah, that happened. I mean, don't look at the crime data. Where does he live? I can walk my dog safely to...
with his security, of course.
Yeah, with his security. But does he really walk his dog? Do you guys remember this video that, I think this was right after he... this was like his first or second week, I think, after Secretary Mayor... previously Vice Admiral of the Canoe Fleet at Camp Wimpetonka, Poop Booty Juice was, it was like his first year or whatever as Transpost Secretary, right? And he was caught by the press, it was set up as a pap shot. He was riding his bike with his dorky little helmet on, riding his little bicycle, but he like stopped, didn't he stop? And he didn't like actually bike all the way to DC, wasn't he in like a vehicle? And then they pulled the vehicle fleet over and they took his bike out and then they put his little dorky helmet on and then he rode his bike for like two blocks. Yep. So do you honestly, okay, he was trying to fake you out about that. Do you really honestly think that this dude walks his dog?
I walk my dog every day.
I don't believe he does. I walk my dog to the Capitol compared to 4 years ago. It was different 4 years ago. This is Poop Booty Juice Juan showing you on the simulcast. This is literally, they drove him two blocks away from the Capitol. Then, hands to sky, they took his bike out. He gets on his bike. He's got his dorky little helmet on. You can see it still when everyone believed that the cloth, the face panty, they thought that was scientific, so you can still see it's in that era. And then he biked to, he thought he was hidden by the trees, y'all. It's like watching a toddler play hide and seek. He thought he was hidden. He's not hidden. You can see him clear as day. He gets on that little bike. He probably don't even know how to work it. I bet that's what he's trying to figure out. Like, where are the brakes on this? What is this? Vice Admiral here of Camp Wimpetonka's Canoe Fleet. Getting on his bike. Bikes for two blocks to the Capitol. you know, with all of his security. Look at all of his people setting up a bike for him. There he goes. He's going to bike, guys. He's biking. He's a serious bicyclist. What? Look, he cares about the environment. Note his security with him. His security's got the bike with the beefy tires, right? He's got like a whole SUV fleet following him. You believe this man walks his dog?
So green.
Hell to the no. Yeah, so green. Look at it. For every bicycle ride that Pete Buttigieg takes, you've got like a fleet of SUVs and a dude on a gas-powered, beefy-tired bike. Yeah, whatever. I don't even care, dude. Stop.
Yeah, he drove his dog to the park and then got out and walked it at the park.
No,
he
didn't drive. His people drove him.
Right.
And then they got the dog out for him and harnessed the dog up. He didn't even touch said dog.
He just walked next to the dog.
He literally had someone squat down and catch the dew in their hand. Just had, yeah, that's what he did. Catch, I don't doubt it.
Catch the dew.
All right. It's my new dog product. I'm calling it booty bags for your dog. It's named after our secretary, Poop Booty Juice. We're trademarking it right now. It's a booty bag. You just sit down, catch the dew. That's literally the tagline. Steal it. I will sue you for everything you have. Right. It's the American way. I'm just saying. Let's see. So it's eclipse mania. Is it? Don't look at me badly. I really don't care. Is that mean to say? Okay. The moon goes in front of the sun. Whoa! I ran out of mouthwash today. I mean, I don't know. Like what? This like. Right? Is that mean to say? I feel like I'm leaving a popular party by saying this. You know how like you just leave, if you're at an event, you got to go and it's an event you know, you feel like you should be at because everybody's there. I feel like everybody's super excited about this eclipse and I just don't care. It's a celestial event. I don't care. Is that mean? Do you care? Are you really excited about this thing?
You mean, am I emotionally attached to what, it
or
so
even
much
remotely to in it? Any, yeah, I mean,
your in interest, your disinterest in it,
yeah,
is somehow makes me upset. No,
okay,
it doesn't.
Okay,
you're all right.
I mean, I would never. The people booked hotel rooms. I feel bad for the people who booked hotel rooms in cloudy areas,
like and ours.
They're walking outside, like, well, gosh, dang it, looking at the sky.
It's the damn government controlling the weather.
It's the chemtrails,
so you don't see the solar eclipse. I see what they're doing.
Somebody got two crystals out and banged him together, right, and squirted some essential oil out. It made everything cloudy. My
or
gosh.
Worse, or worse.
I just don't care about it. I if I see it, woo. If I don't, okay. Is that weird to say that? I don't get excited about stuff. Yeah. Now, if it was sweet meteor of death, I would be out there ready. I'd be out there like that Timothy Chalamet from Dune with my two anchors ready to ride that thing. I just get ready to, like, how you got to see the movie. Anyway, all right, we got to get moving because we got headlines coming up and the eclipse is making us all dumb. We're going to start talking backwards or something. I bet that's what happens, right? If we don't get hit by a rock and aliens don't come, we'll probably start talking backwards and everything will be dark and we're going to have to sacrifice somebody to make the sun come back. And I don't know. We'll just see. All right, we got it's that kind of a day. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So, is the solar eclipse going to disrupt your cell service? No, you're just going to talk backwards and sound like a devil. That's all. That's all it is. I don't even want to say it's a joke. I'm just in the very sardonic mood. I love how this article starts. As darkness envelops millions of people during Monday's total solar eclipse, I know, right? Drama. They just want to know if their cell phones are going to work. I can't wait for the flood of blurry photos to be on Instagram. So is my cell service going to work so I can post it up on Instagram? You better be using Patriot Mobile, by the way. Otherwise, you're just supporting the devil. I don't know what else to tell you. Let's see here. Parts of New York State, they're apparently not going to see the total eclipse anymore. If you're in Hudson Valley, nature decided to do a takesies backsies for you, and you're not going to get to see it anymore. Yeah, they updated all the times for that, so bummer. Let's see. If you forgot to get solar eclipse glasses, you can literally put a colander on your head. Apparently, that's what somebody suggested. I don't really think these glasses work. I don't know. I just think it's all goofy. Here's the idea. When it looks dark out, sneak a peek. And then when the sun comes back out, don't look at it. That's real simple. Do you have to spend $5 on glasses?
I hear that the most dangerous part is that little bit leading up to the total eclipse, but the actual total eclipse you can look
the
right
at. The corona around it, not the beer. The corona around it, you're not going to fry your eyes out. But if you have the wrong glasses on and you're staring at it, you realize you're cooking your eye. You're making an eyeball souffle. Maybe don't do that. So just, when it looks dark, sneak a peek. You don't have to stare at it forever. Just sneak a peek. I'm just saying, if you don't have the glasses. Let's see here. Forecast for cloudy skies. Cast a shadow over North American solar eclipse times. Apparently, you got to either fly above the clouds or get a drone. I don't care. And Morgan Whalen was arrested. That has nothing to do with the eclipse. You're like, why is Morgan Whalen in this? It's because how it is, how we structured it today. He apparently threw a chair at the Chiefs bar last night, and he's got 3 counts of reckless endangerment and 1 count of disorderly conduct. I thought this was America, officer. The police said the chair landed just 3 feet away from him. So he bonded out at $15,000. So he was under arrest. We have a lot more in store, including Eclipse Mania, culture, GOP, abortion. Stay with us. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
People will say, oh, my power bill is constantly going up. Mm-hmm. What do you say to people here in Georgia who may feel that frustration?
You're seeing the impacts really of climate change on people's heating bills, not just in Georgia, but around the country.
It's called going into summer. You clown poops. That's what it's called. Going into summer and you're in Georgia and we live in a time of inflation. That's what it's called. But no, you got Democrats who are running all of this, making all of these decisions that are jacking up prices. So they got to think, oh, it's the boogeyman of climate change. Ooh, climate change is going to get you. Welcome back to the show. Dana Lash here with you. That was Jennifer Granholm, another diversity hire. They hired one guy because he's gay. They hired her because she's abroad. That's why. Let's just be honest about it. So she's the energy secretary. She's saying, oh, well, the reason that prices are increasing, it's, climate change. Couldn't be Biden's economic policies. It couldn't be the fact that you guys are restricting the energy sector. It couldn't be any of those things. It has to be the ghost of weather. It's what it is. Can we throw up this audio from The View? Because I've even seen the left say, because you got, now hold up. You had the earthquakes, Taiwan earthquake. Then you had the earthquake on the East Coast. And now because there was an earthquake on the East Coast, everybody thinks that everything bad is going to happen now because people are so damn self-centered. Anything happens in New York and everyone immediately assumes that it's the end of the world because how could it happen to me? It's, New York. It's where the media is. So the media internalizes everything. And then you got the cicadas, the two groups of the weird cicadas coming up. Yeah. And now you've got the eclipse. And all these broads are saying that it's because of like climate change and end times. I'm waiting for one of them to bring out snakes to use in their worship practices. Watch.
kind of crazy is with the earthquake on Friday and then the eclipse today, people are having all sorts of conspiracies about the end of the world. And then I read online that the earthquake epicenter was actually at Bedminster
in New
Jersey.
This is the WorldNet Daily Nepo baby.
So fun fact. So it originated with Trump.
I have to say, I know, right? I mean, I have to say, Karen Dupiche, our wonderful,
oh
one
my
of our
gosh.
Wonderful makeup artists, when the earthquake was happening, she put her coat on and she was like, Jesus is coming.
I'm out.
I'm out. I'm leaving. We've got a solar eclipse. We've
she
got the earthquake.
The
she ran down the hallway.
The rapture is here.
The rapture's here. And then also I learned that the cicadas are coming.
Cicadas.
Although I love the first
what?
Time.
I'm sorry. Stop.
Like,
no, that was supposed to be breaks. Full stop. How out of touch are you if you don't even know what that bug's called? Everybody knows what that bug's called. Kareen. Cicada. It's not like a jazz quartet. Yeah. It's a bug.
Or a cheese.
Welcome. We're the Cicadas. We're a Dave Brubeck cover band. Like, what is the matter with you? Stop. It's a cicada. Cicada.
Put cicada.
What in bougie Nordstrom hell is that? Cicada.
It's like Prada.
What is that? I can't even get into the rest of this video. That one took me by surprise. Well played. Well played. Because they got into, you had the Nepo baby and the conspiracy theories. And then they were, so they ended up saying, well, you know, we've got also the eclipse happening.
Who could have predicted that?
I don't know. The people who predicted it 70 years ago. And then the people who predicted it 70 years before that. And 70 years before that. And 70 years before that. They can do those things. They can, it's like a, they can, it's not, they're not prophets. They just pay attention to the weather and, you know, gravitational forces and all this kind of stuff. It's not hard. Cicada. Good grief. Almost makes it sound like a delicacy. That's nasty. But they, I can't tell you how many things I've seen where people are suggesting that the eclipse is somehow like a climate event. Wow, can you believe it? The weather is so hot that it just pulled the moon right into the sun. Oh, man. Guys, these people vote. Can you believe that? They drive cars near you. Well, some of them don't, but good night. It's not that at all. No worries, guys. Don't, let's not say we did. So, we got the eclipse mania. We'll talk more about, apparently there's three things you're not supposed to do. I think we kind of covered it, though. We were touching on the student loan proposal. So Trump has said, he came out with this video where he mentioned, he was talking about abortion, came out with this video, says that abortion should be left to the states. He said there should be, there are exceptions for rape incest. He didn't specify a week limit. It was a 4-minute video that he posted to his social media platform. And this was, you know, this is an issue that Democrats are desperately trying to make a big thing, but a national big thing. Do we have some, of his video here. He came out and he said that it should be left up to the states. And he celebrated the Supreme Court overturning Roe v. Wade. And he said that he was proud of that being done. We'll play some of this. This is audio soundbite. I got a flashback, but I don't want the flashback. I want the big video. We should have it. Let's see if we can get that pulled up. But he had said previously that he would support a 15-week federal level ban, but this is him saying that he likes for it to be state by state. Can we play this, please? Go ahead. Juan's pulling it up right now.
We will always support the creation of strong, thriving, and healthy American families. We want to make it easier for mothers and families to have babies, not harder. That includes supporting the availability of fertility treatments like IVF in every state in America. Like the overwhelming majority of Americans, including the vast majority of Republicans, conservatives, Christians, and pro-life Americans, I strongly support the availability of IVF for couples who are trying to have a precious baby. What could be more beautiful or better than that? Today, I'm pleased that the Alabama legislature has acted very quickly and passed legislation.
I will say, I do, and I get some of what people are saying. Because there are some people who are criticizing him, saying you literally were going after people like Ron DeSantis and Brian Kemp and others for passing their own state legislation regarding that. Yes, he was. He did. This is where he kind of gets in his own way. I don't like that he used the phrase abortion rights because I don't believe that that's a thing. Just like I don't think that's an existent, that doesn't, you got to be careful about the language that you use and to not validate your opposition by using their language. So I think that, and this is why you have to be careful in a primary. You can't just, you know, throw punches and not have any regard for the future. Because now there are going to be some people, and I'm seeing them right now, they're questioning his sincerity and whether or not he would actually stick to that because he was so combative with governors that were doing this in their own states. And I think that that's a perfectly justifiable thing to point out. I mean, you're literally just pointing to the stuff that he actually wrote and posted on his own platform and in things that he said in interviews. If this is his position, then aside from the fact that he said abortion rights, I don't think that it's a bad political position. And we're going to talk more about that because we've got to look at past, we've got to look at how some of these issues have been performing in elections and how to do it better. One thing too, this is what I get really aggravated about. Whenever anyone, people I know, good people who are pro-life, whenever I see them try to have a conversation about this issue, and they are trying to discuss strategy in which that you would use to protect life going state by state. And then they're accused, which is the formula of calling someone a racist that the left uses. They're accused of not being pro-life or as pro-life by people who are like the Susan B. Anthony organization. And I don't dislike them, but I see some people really trying to impugn the characters of others by suggesting that somehow they are less devoted to life because they have a different strategy. I find that specious. I find it malicious. I find it leftist. And I find it undermining the very cause that you're stating that you want to go out and support, that the cause that you want to champion. And there's a reason why I say this. If you look at some of the past six elections where you've looked at it state by state, pro-lifers haven't done too well. Some of it's messaging. Actually, I think all of it's messaging. It's not because that doesn't sell. It's because you've got to get better at the messaging. And you can't be having these fights about strategy like this way out in the open. And be accusing people of being less, having less of a regard for life because they want to approach it state by state incrementally so it's not an all or nothing gamble for them. And you can't have this be all or nothing or you will lose. It is an incremental fight. And it's also a stronger, by doing it incrementally, it's legally stronger, which we're going to talk about coming up. But his remark, I didn't like that he used, he posted on his platform, he said abortion rights. And you can't use that phrase. Is he, two things. Is he the best messenger? No. Is he conservative on this issue? No. But is this a strategic pathway that actually would cement and place safeguards and gain pro-life more than they've gained thus far electorally, state by state, and taking the fight like this? Yes, I actually think this is a smarter move. There's a reason why Democrats are trying to make this a federal issue. There's a reason why. They are fighting this going state by state. And it's not because they don't think they can win. If they wanted to marshal their forces, they could. It's easier for them to try to make this a federal issue, and they need it as a get-out-the-vote mechanism. Do not grant them this. We'll talk more about this coming up, because we have Days of These United States as well. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it? That's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor-selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
Okay, if you don't feel safe, get off the airplane.
But this is your captain speaking, okay. But never like this.
I'll stop, and we'll fly the airplane. Right. Don't worry, I'm going to let my co-pilot fly it. He's a man. Okay?
It's a total meltdown. The pilot boarded in her street clothes and addressed the passengers over the intercom. Passenger Pam O'Neill couldn't believe what was happening.
She said, let's take a vote. How many of you would like to take off now with me dressed as I am? Or would you prefer that I take 10 minutes to get changed into my cute little uniform? Then she started talking about her divorce and political candidates. And the minute she mentioned that, a gentleman stood up and just yelled, whoa, enough, you're scaring me.
Another passenger, Randy Reese, got up to leave and gave a running commentary on social media. Pilot also insulted a couple on board.
Did I offend you? Okay, so did I purposely offend you? I did.
Oh my gosh.
The answer's yes. Flight attendants, please disarm doors.
After 20 passengers insisted on getting off the United Airlines flight, the pilot quietly left the aircraft.
Okay, if you don't feel safe, get off the airplane.
Yeah, I hope she's fired and she has her license revoked permanently. I don't ever think that she should ever fly a plane again.
That's United.
That is insane. I would have gotten off the plane.
Yeah.
I would have withheld the urge to punch her in the face, but I would have gotten off the plane. There's no way in hell I'd have let that woman fly me. That's insane. You've never seen a man pilot do that. Just saying. Be like, woman, you need a whole bottle of Midol. Chill.
I haven't even seen other female pilots do that.
True. That's insane. That is insane. What is wrong with people? Like the sense of entitlement, your cute little uniform. There's standards for a reason, sweetheart. Get off the plane. Oh, I would have been, the moment she would have opened her mouth, I would have been up and out. No way. No way. I wouldn't have flown with her on the plane either. She would have had to literally be off the aircraft. No way. No way. That's crazy. Some of us have issues enough with being in a little metal tube in the sky with people. You know, without that on top of it. But she felt like she was inoculated from any kind of criticism or accountability because she's a chick. A lot of women on the left feel like that. They think that they're inoculated from any kind of criticism or accountability for their actions because they're not just a woman, but they're a woman on the left. Because, you know, if you're a woman and you are independent or rightward leaning or on the right, that negates your vagina. I don't know if you realize that, but it cancels that out. You are genderless after that. That's a thing that the left does. Bippity boppity boo. But the idea, I mean, that she got up there and just thought that that was perfectly acceptable. That's insane. And I don't like her hat. I didn't like her hat either. I just didn't like anything about her at all. Immediately, she didn't have to say nothing. And I'm like, Karen. Okay, Cynthia. That's it. That's, would you have flown on? You'd have gotten up too, wouldn't you?
I would have said something snarky.
Well, yeah, but you would not
definitely
have
gotten out after saying the snarky thing. Or I would have said the snarky thing while walking out. One of the two.
I probably would have stood up and said something snarky. Yeah. And then,
like, wow, did all the sandwiches get made already? Or?
Yeah. What happened? The sandwiches get made? What in the world? Like this, she just, what's wrong with her?
So horrible.
I have my co-pilot, a man. She sounded bitter and she sounded resentful, bitter, and hateful. Mm-hmm. She was mad. Like, was she mad because she had a co-pilot with a dude? Notice the dude pilot didn't say nothing. He wasn't even out there. He was, like, probably busy doing, you know, all of the pre-flight stuff that they got to do. Don't they have like a whole checklist of stuff they got to do? Yeah.
The things to do to keep people alive. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like how to keep people alive when we're in the air. Yeah. I mean, he's running through that whole checklist. And meanwhile, Cynthia's out there. Rabble. Like giving, and then she's talking about her divorce and everything else. Is that what the passenger said? And when she got into political candidates too, no. Look, there's certain professions where you take a back seat. Be humble enough. Be humble enough and have a servant's heart and take a back seat. The world isn't owed your political opinions. They're not owed your hot takes. If you're a doctor and you're in somebody's guts, you know, wrist deep, shut up about your politics. Nobody cares. Be a doctor. We need those people more than we need people running their mouths off about politics. I'm just saying. We got enough of us, all right? Stick with us. We got a whole other hour on the way. More of The Dana Show back after this. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
The Dana Show.
I'm not going to get ahead of the president or decisions he might or might not make going forward. He was very clear in his call with the prime minister that if we don't see some changes in their policies in Gaza and the way they're prosecuting operations, we're going to have to make some changes
so
of our own.
You do think these are Israeli policies then to block aid?
They get to decide how they prosecute this war. It's their operation. We just talked about them pulling troops out and what that means. They get to decide how they prosecute operations. We get to decide how we're going to react to that and how we're going to administer our own policy with respect to Gaza. We make those decisions. And the president was clear with the prime minister. If there's not changes, if things don't get better, then we're going to have to make changes of our own.
So what do you mean, like, if things don't get better? Like, what things are you talking about? What do you mean, what gets better? John Kirby, I'm curious. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lashier with you. Top of the second hour. Oh, I know. We're in the midst of eclipse mania. We'll talk about it. Apparently, a partial eclipse is now visible in Mexico. Anyway. Kane's laughing at me. Dana Lash with you. You can listen coast to coast. Find us on channel 347 DirecTV. We're all over the webernets. On X as well. The requirements? What are the requirements? I don't quite understand. Apparently, there was some movement towards Rafah, but that was kind of like the latest. But I'm trying to what are the requirements? I saw the survey that almost half of British Muslims support Hamas. Did you guys see this? I told you they were very, very popular. Hamas is super popular. There was a survey that was done in Britain, and 46%, according to the Telegraph, of British Muslims said they sympathize with Hamas, not even support Hamas. That this goes like above and beyond, like they are sympathetic to them. It's the largest of its kind carried out since the conflict began. There was a smaller one that was done just in Gaza by a Gaza, aka Hamas entity. There was another one done in December of last year, still after October 7th. That was done by an independent, it was an independent firm, a survey. They were actually surveying people in Gaza. I don't know how you survey people in a, you know, a war zone, but okay. And now this one. They said a third of British Muslims, 32%, want to see Sharia law, Islamic jurisprudence, implemented in the UK. This is all post-October 7th. That's crazy. And only one in four British Muslims believed that Hamas committed rape and murder in Israel. The majority actually think that it's just made up and that Israel deserved it. This is wild to read this. But it kind of answers your question as to how do you have this viewpoint internationally of Hamas, and how is it? I mean, this is how is it? How are people thinking like this? Well, that's, you know, they've been sold. It's all been propaganda. We talked about this. So we have Kirby saying, giving a very vague statement. Well, you know, unless some things change, but they, you know, they don't exactly say what needs to change. They don't exactly get into that. And then you have this Jamal Bowman. He's the guy who pulled the fire alarm, remember, and tried to disrupt House proceedings. Audio soundbite 6. He's talking about the, remember, we had the problem with Democrats in Michigan with Gaza. Now he's talking about the problem that Gaza is creating for Muslim voters in Wisconsin. Listen.
Yes, because we've always had a problem engaging voters of color, young people in certain demographics. It's going to be harder now because of how we respond, have pretty much not responded very well to what's happening in Gaza.
Mm-hmm. Because they're sold lies. It's just wild. Just wild to see this. I encounter it on social media with stuff that I post. I actually had to delete a couple. I never delete comments on Instagram. I actually had to delete a couple of comments on Instagram because they were pretty Hamas-y, where people were saying, well, yeah, you know, this was in response to what the, you know, what Israel's done. October 7th, really, putting grenades in women's copulatory organs. That's you think that that's a justifiable response to what? Hamas are the colonizers. Realize that Israel gave that strip over to colonizers. It's being colonized. That's the actual occupation. Hamas occupies it. That's the truth of it. But this is wild to see everyone fold like this. And even Nancy Pelosi, I'm pulling this up. So you have Pelosi who's sending a letter as well, along with a number of other House members, demanding that Biden stop selling weapons to Israel. They want to halt all arms transfers to Israel. Now, you tell me, why is it that the world believes that Israel targeted 7 aid workers in Gaza on purpose, but that Hamas didn't on purpose target over 1,600 innocent people on October 7th? That's the question. So now Nancy Pelosi is demanding that Biden halt arm transfers. They don't want a new arms package for Israel. They think that anything remotely similar to it should be withheld. They said that Israel should mitigate harm to innocent civilians in Gaza, including aid workers. Kane, you all right over there?
So we're cutting off weapons to an ally?
Yeah.
In a time of, certainly this is war.
This is siding with Hamas.
Yeah, there's no doubt.
There's no other way to put it. This is siding with Hamas, the terror entity that somehow Democrats, a significant number of Democrats here in the United States, are sympathizing with. And they keep saying that Israel's done this great wrong. What great wrong did they do? No one's ever actually been able to articulate that. I asked people that were the Hamasi people in my Instagram comments. I will literally bounce you. Like, you are not, these type of people need to realize that they do not deserve my attention, nor are they owed it. And these people are irrelevant to me. I will bounce your ass right out. They were going after some of you all, some of my other commenters on Instagram in a pretty nasty way, and I had to delete some of them. And if they keep doing it, I'm going to have to actually put a filter on some of the words used. But they've never been able to actually articulate what the big bad that Israel's done. Literally, the only thing that they've ever been able to say is that Israel's Jewish, and that's it. Like, it's the wildest thing. They've never been able to say, well, what is it that they did that you think necessitated that response? Because they're, like, defending it. It gets worse. Wait a minute. Wait. Listen to this. This is audio soundbite 4. This is in, where do you think this is, Kane?
This would have to be like in Iran or
something. Yeah, let's go ahead and play it. Let's go ahead and play it first. Chants of death to America are erupt in the streets of this town. Watch.
We've been asked in the past, why are our protests on the International Day of Quds, why are they so anti-America? Why don't we just focus more on Israel and not talk so much about America? Gaza has shown the entire world why these protests are so anti-America. because it's the United States government that provides the funds for all of the atrocities that we just heard about. And this is why Imam Khomeini, who declared the International Day of Quds, this is why he would say to pour all of your chants and all of your shouts upon the head of America.
Wow. Chance of death to America. That was in Dearborn, Michigan.
Michigan? USA, Michigan? Mm-hmm.
See, Biden is willing to sacrifice the only ally that we have in the Middle East to make those people happy so he can get their votes. The people that were screaming death to America, Biden wants their votes very badly. And so he's going to sacrifice Israel so he can make those people happy. The people screaming death to America. This is why I can never be in elected office. Because I respect the Constitution too much to serve in elected office. Because my reaction would have been to round them up on the streets like the country that they so admire and show them what tyranny really, really means behind closed doors in a brutal fashion. That's what I would do. That's me. That's why I can't be in elected office, because I freely admit I'll be like Gladriel with the one ring. The streets of Dearborn, Michigan, filled with the chants of death to America. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Democrats, mm-hmm. you know, Pelosi out there wanting, you know, to stop the arms to Israel. What will this do when, let's say, China and Taiwan get all squirrely? Does this now prove?
Oh, they've already bent the knee. They've already said, oh, Taiwan doesn't deserve to be recognized as its own sovereign entity.
Yeah, so they won't stand with Taiwan there no. either. They've already made that clear. What are, on the international stage, who are we standing with exactly?
That's a question maybe for Yates.
Yeah.
Because I actually don't have an answer for you. I don't know. I really don't know. I don't know. I don't know who. Who it is. That's kind of wild. But that's the reality of it. And that's what Democrats are pushing forward. They're wanting to make, they want to make those voters happy. Those are the voters that they're looking to make happy. Now, speaking of voters and going into 2024, as I said earlier, we played some of this. The former president, the RNC nominee now, Trump, came out and said that he supports he was happy that Roe v. Wade was undone. He supports states' rights. He came out in favor of IVF and said that this abortion is an issue that should be left up to the states. Now, two issues. I think that his position strategically is the correct one, and I'm going to explain that. However, I don't like the fact that he said abortion rights in his statement. Don't use the language of the left to denounce the left, number one. Number two, I do think that primary Trump is at odds with general Trump, because you can't go hard in the primary and go after all these governors for doing within their state what you're now saying that you support. So that creates a problem. Because it gave the impression, and I don't think that he ever actually changed his position on this, but his hardcore opposition to Florida's pro-life law that passed through their legislature, that his hardcore opposition and criticism of that and his criticism of what Georgia did definitely sold the optic that he was against states' rights on this. Absolutely. And he was a lot quieter about where he stood with it being in support of states' rights than he was the federal. So that's created a problem for him, or at least for the people who are trying to figure out where he stands most sincerely on the issue. I think what his statement, though, what he is projecting strategically is correct. And the reason I say that is because pro-life issues have been taking a beating at the ballot box, and pro-life groups, As united as they are, sometimes they seem so fractured, because you have the Susan B. Anthony group, which they do great work, but they go out there and they say it's all or nothing. Well, that's, you're guaranteed to lose if you don't look at it, I think, as an incremental fight. And I don't think that it's fair to impugn someone else's character or question their commitment to pro-life causes because they're looking at an incremental strategy as opposed to an all or nothing strategy. I find that incredibly disingenuous. And I feel like, particularly for people of faith, it betrays the faith that you claim and the God that you claim to serve. So don't cast aspersions on the characters of others simply because they favor an incremental over an all or nothing approach because they want to have lasting wins. That being said, and we're going to talk more about this, we got Yates coming up as well, but this going state by state, I think, makes it harder for Democrats. Democrats want this to be abortion to be a national issue. That's why they had Kamala Harris going into the abortion clinic and all this stuff. They wanted it to be a national issue so bad. And I think Trump robbed that from them. Regardless of where you stand on him as a candidate, I think this was a strategically correct move to make. And it's a legally safe one because it's a lot harder to go at abortion state by state than it is federally. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So, I didn't know this was a thing, but apparently insurers are spying on your home from the sky. Companies have started using drones to check out your roof or to spot yard debris or even an undeclared trampoline. And the Wall Street Journal has stories, of these people who have been dropped by their home insurance and they were told, it had to do with some aerial photos of your roof, like this one couple, and their insurer refused to let them see. I just feel like if there's a drone over my house, I shooty down, right? Like, you're in my airspace and I'm territorial. Like, I am North Korea. I will shoot it down if I see it in my airspace. Done.
I want an eagle trained to take them down. Have you seen those?
I don't think you can own an eagle or a falcon. You could get like a falconer license.
That's still what I want, though.
I just, sidebar, would love to add that onto like my business card. I have like business cards that say my name and then that's it. And I really don't give them out. But I would like to put like, you know, radio host and also falconer, right? Just, right? Just sounds like a very noble position to have, just saying. Let's see. Gas prices have gone ballistic in California. Oh my gosh, this is so true. So guess what? They're at $5.27 per gallon. That's what they were on Friday. That's the average. About $6 a gallon. That's crazy.
What? It's like twice what we're paying.
That's
here.
Insane. Oh my heavens. Apparently our sense of smell can help wipe out depression and dementia. They're using scents to treat, you know, for mental health issues. I feel like that's subjective per person though, I think. Apparently, let's see, it's National Beer Day. Really, what kind of beer? Like good beer? We don't know. Stephen Yates joins us next. We got lots of questions for him. Stay with us. So you know how important being prepared is to me, and that's why I want you to know about my good friends at ReadyWise Emergency Food. Now, you've heard me talk about them as Wise Foods. ReadyWise Emergency Food is the same company, but with more options. Being prepared with ReadyWise Emergency Food gives you peace of mind that you'll have delicious, nutritious meals on hand to feed your family. They're also great for fishing and hunting and hiking adventures. They have a huge selection of freeze-dried meals from breakfast to pasta dishes that'll be good to eat when you need it with their 25-year shelf life. ReadyWise is an American company, so that means you're supporting American jobs when you choose ReadyWise. Visit ReadyWise.com and use promo code Dana20 at checkout for 20% off of any regularly priced item. That's ReadyWise.com, promo code Dana20.
The families of the hostages gathered together over the weekend to commemorate this 6-month hell they've been going through. Not a single member of Netanyahu's government attended that. And the reason why is because all along, the families have been shunned, ignored, sidelined, disrespected. Netanyahu hasn't wanted a hostage deal. There's been many occasions where he could have had a deal, but he hasn't wanted one because that would bring...
So this is some guy named Ed Luce, who's some dilly bar head who writes for Financial Times. Somebody, we're using him for a soundbite, jumping off purpose. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash with you, bottom of the second hour. He's saying that Netanyahu never wanted a hostage deal because he's rejected previous offers. You mean the ones where they were saying, we demand that you release 400 terrorists that are imprisoned in exchange for maybe some of the hostages, none of which include the babies that we kidnapped? That doesn't seem like a genuine offer to me. And so I get the rejection. I also understand, though, the criticism that his administration has slow-walked the response, particularly to clearing out some of the battalions of terrorists in Rafah. I get it. But at the same time, why are they listening to anybody else, especially a country, us, the United States, that took 20 years to reinstall the Taliban? And then we also got a bunch of people killed and then droned 10 people to death. We're going to turn around and lecture them because they're taking a few months to rout out a terrorist group? Come on. Joining us now on this, and then we're going to be pivoting to China, our good friend Stephen Yates, and you can find him at YatesComms on X, senior fellow at the America First Policy Institute and chair of the China Policy Initiative. So, Stephen, always good to see you this Eclipse Mania Monday. This I really reject that framing that the left keeps putting up, that it's Israel that's rejected any kind of offer of hostage release or any kind of agreement, because that's not a serious offer coming from Hamas. Release all these terrorists and maybe we'll give you some of the hostages back.
Yeah, well, you know, there is an internationalized form of Trump derangement syndrome, and it basically is, if your dominant frame is you really hate a particular political leader, and no matter what, anything he says or does is not enough, it's not good, it's inherently evil. A lot of these people that are covering this think that about Benjamin Netanyahu, and they might have chapter and verse that explains why they've arrived at this august conclusion. But I don't know how any reasonable person can look at Hamas, an internationally recognized terrorist organization, murdering, killing, raping, all the things we know they did. It's on video and people need to refresh their memories of what this actually was, has kept hostages to this date. And whether Netanyahu would or wouldn't make a deal, our president of the United States doesn't even mention the names of the remaining American hostages. I mean, back in the late 1970s into the 1980 election cycle, we had a news media that put some fire on the Carter administration by giving a calendar of days of how many days our hostages had been held by the Iranians. Why isn't there a similar daily reminder that these poor souls remain unaccounted for by our president? And until that's taken care of, what is this deal making we're talking of? And if there are innocent civilians that are getting hurt, I feel badly for them, but I did not allow terrorists to take root in my neighborhood, to dig tunnels under my hospitals, schools, and other important infrastructure. I think Americans are pretty frustrated by all of this manipulation and misinformation. And really, we got hit. Israel wasn't the only one getting hit. And shouldn't we want to eliminate the terrorist organization that did it within every reasonable means available to us?
I think that's a great point. I mean, and with this, also Nancy Pelosi now with a number of other Democrats sending a letter saying, no, we don't agree to the arms package. No more arms packages for Israel, essentially cutting them off from being able to obtain new weapons. That's a pretty big deal to the only ally that we have in that area. And that's like this is one of three insane things that the administration has done just within the past week. Your quick thought on that?
Well, number one, I don't know how we're going to have any allies in the world if we continue to treat allies like this. I was lectured to incessantly about the value of alliances and the need to unequivocally and without any limits support Ukraine, actually not a treaty ally of the United States against Russia, because it would send a signal to Taiwan and China that the U.S. will stand by its allies. Well, here's an example of a treaty ally being attacked by a terrorist organization, and now the United States is threatening not to provide material support to that ally in a time of war and crisis. How would that reassure Japan, Taiwan, or anyone in the South China Sea that the United States' big galaxy brains from the Ivy Leagues aren't going to come up with some condition for them to have a preemptive retreat in the face of PRC aggression? This is actually kind of nonsensical and toxic. They've left their minds behind, and it's only driven by politics, either the electoral college politics or the ideology of they just hate Netanyahu so much, almost as much as they hate Trump, and so this has to be bad.
Now, that's a good point. Talking with our friend Stephen Yates, you can find him on X at YatesComms. The signal sending to allies, you mentioned Taiwan. Well, then, of course, this was one of the three in the hat trick that the administration pulled last week. You had John Kirby go out and say that the United States doesn't recognize Taiwan's independence, doesn't recognize it. Is that a significant about face on that the whole approach that we had, the vague policy that we had towards Taiwan previously?
Well, sadly, it isn't really a change of policy. We've had a lot of dough-brained leaders spout this kind of policy for a very long time. It's one way to make a communist very, very happy to see you willfully say something you know is not true because you're afraid they're going to do something bad. That basically is an admission of dominance over you. And that's what that policy is. The People's Republic of China has never controlled Taiwan, period. Right. Since the founding of the Communist Party of China through the Civil War and to this day, they have never controlled Taiwan. And so when people talk about the status quo is a Taiwan that lives independent of the People's Republic of China. And so I don't know why Kirby or anyone else has to dance around this. The status quo is independence. China wants to make Taiwan completely dependent on the People's Republic. That's what all of this is about. And since when do you sell arms to someone that is, not independent of the threat that they're trying to fight? I mean, it just doesn't add up at a basic level. I'm just of the view that we're not pushing this. It's the CCP that's pushing all this stuff. And if we aim to resist it, we should strengthen the resistors without our having to commit what we would do one way or the other. That seems to be too complex for a lot of these galaxy brains, but it's where we got to go.
Yeah, because I've never heard an administration actually say that before. And I know we've talked about this, really under Democrat and Republican administrations, they've always had that strategic ambiguity where they've never said it. I think it was Trump that got in trouble. Didn't he call their leader after they had an election and then there was some drama?
Their leader called
that
to congratulate him, yes, on getting elected. What a profound and destabilizing behavior.
Oh, exactly. Just so shocking. But he never went out and said, oh, we recognize their independence. But he did call and congratulate, the leader on winning, the latest election. This Kirby saying we don't recognize their independence. My first thought, and this is as conspiracy theorist as I get, my first thought was, okay, what spooked them? Why the need for that?
Well, there are a lot of things that spook them that don't necessarily spook the normals of our society. Number one, they actually believe the climate crisis is an existential threat and that we're all doomed unless we get cooperation from China and unless we get a whole bunch of stuff imported from China, mm-hmm, and somehow working with the world's largest, most prolific polluter is going to save the planet. I can't square that. But for them, that's a massive, massive priority. And so they don't want to unnerve that channel of dialogue. They also just had Secretary Yellen go, and she's going to talk about how to manage the economic relationship. I'm of the view, I don't know that you can have a normal economic relationship with a country that poisons you with COVID and fentanyl, steals everything from semiconductors to a car gigapress, and is involved in undermining the war you said was righteous and helping defend Ukraine. They're deeply embedded in helping Russia against Ukraine. So I don't see where they go with this, but that's what they're doing. They're repeating the mantras of the past to try to keep the program of the past going uninterrupted. But Xi Jinping is interrupting that.
Yeah. And you mentioned Janet Yellen. Can we play audio soundbite two really quickly? This was her talking about this. Everyone's using Gwyneth Paltrow's words, decoupling from China. Listen to this.
During conversations this week, I underscored again that the United States does not seek to decouple from China. Our two economies are deeply integrated, and a wholesale separation would be disastrous for both of our economies.
To cut into her, it seems like, Stephen, that there's so much effort being made these past several days to make assurances to China for some reason. And I just, like, what am I missing? Like, what happened? Like, why all of a sudden this huge need to pat them on the back and do the hand-holding and act like, no, we still support all the stuff that you're doing? I mean, we sit here and we lecture about human rights as it relates to 7 AIDS workers over the 1,600 that were killed by Hamas, but we say nothing about the imprisonment going on in northwestern China? What in the world?
Or the political prisoners in Hong Kong, the threat to Taiwan, and all this other stuff. Yeah. And by the way, she said nothing really about the American platforms that are denied access to China. China's the one that's been into the decoupling thing. I don't ever remember signing on to a marriage, much less going steady with the Communist Party of China. So to me, I mean, decoupling might not match because I never thought we were a couple. But I think that we should be becoming less dependent. She tried to say as much, that that we don't want to be too dependent on them and they're trying to take over the market. I think that's probably the most truth she spoke in the entire exchange. But nothing she's saying or doing is making us less dependent or helping us take more control over the markets that we should be doing, not by manipulation, but by competing. We need to unleash American energy. We need to deregulate our economy. We need to do a better job of presenting better options to Americans and our allies. And if we do those things, we can contain the malign influences of the CCP, and we can have sort of a doe-eyed deer go to China and say, oh, we just want to get along. But until we do those things, this is kind of double danger. She's giving them the pablum of the past and not really changing any policy to make us less dependent and less at risk. So decoupling is the word they want to hit. Maybe it's not the right word, but they're definitely not minimizing or lessening our risk. And that supposedly was their genius alternative, de-risking.
Last quick question, talking with our friend Stephen Yates. Since everything happened after you were on last week, all of this a flood of foreign policy, Ukraine and NATO, you had Blinken go out and say, well, yeah, Ukraine will be a member of NATO. They didn't give a timeline for it. Why? Why in the world?
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know. I was kind of surprised by that. I might be the only one that was surprised, but I was kind of surprised by that. I also thought since the grown-ups were back, we would consult with our allies. I don't think every NATO member had been consulted about this declaration by the United States. That was what I thought used to be called unilateralism.
Yeah.
And by the way, it has been an openly discussed red line for Russia from the beginning of this escalation. And I don't believe in kind of giving in to an adversary's red lines, but you do need to be deliberate about if we're going to cross it. Am I really prepared to belly up for the risk and the response? And I don't think that the American people feel like that. And frankly, I'd be surprised if the rest of Europe had already bought into that idea. So I thought it was an outlier. It was surprising and basically pretty hypocritical given the general foreign policy lectures we've been served for the last 3 years.
Yeah, completely agree. Stephen Yates at Yates Comms. Always a pleasure, my friend. Happy Eclipse Mania Monday. I'm not really excited about it. It's like a celestial event. I feel like, you know, I'm the odd man out because I'm like, it's okay. It's, you know, the moon going in front of the sun. Woo. I don't know.
Yeah. I'm for the light.
See, there you go. There you go. We're killjoys together. Stephen Yates at Yates Comms. Always a pleasure, my friend. Thank you. Good to see you. Have a great week.
Thank you, Dana. Take care.
Thanks for watching The Dana Show. Make sure to like, subscribe, ring the bell, and stay tuned for more content.